The European Central Bank sticks with its plan for a big rate hike despite the ongoing volatility in the financial markets. The ECB raised interest rates by 50 basis points as promised on Thursday, noting that inflation is projected to remain too high for too long. It has assured the public that it is monitoring the current market tensions and stands ready to respond to preserve financial stability. The central bank's top bosses also moved to calm nerves over worries about Credit Suisse, which was hit by contagion fears from the U.S.
Looking at the exposure, for instance, to Credit Suisse, they are quite limited, and there is no concentration. There is no single counterparty that concentrates a large part of that exposure.
The euro area banking sector is resilient, with strong capital and liquidity positions. In any case, our policy toolkit is fully equipped to provide liquidity support to the euro area financial system if needed, and to preserve the smooth transmission of monetary policy.
News overseas now, U.S. Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen says America's banking system remains strong. That's despite the growing regional banking crisis triggered by the collapse of California-based lender Silicon Valley Bank. Speaking to the Senate Finance Committee, Yellen also said emergency measures to protect SVB and enhance banking liquidity will not hurt taxpayers.
I can reassure the members of the committee that our banking system is sound and that Americans can feel confident that their deposits will be there when they need them. Importantly, no taxpayer money is being used or put at risk with this action. Deposit protection is provided by the Deposit Insurance Fund, which is funded by fees on banks.
After the collapse of Silicon Valley Bank, U.S. regulators moved to close down New York-based Signature Bank. Another regional bank, First Republic, has also come under threat, but just yesterday, Thursday, a group of financial institutions came to the rescue with a $30 billion deposit pledge in a move that aims to shore up confidence in the U.S. banking system. Now, before we go, a Danish company is gaining ground for its business of growing agricultural produce through vertical farming. Take a look.
At this 14-story tall farm on the outskirts of Copenhagen, you'll find everything from lettuce to kale and thyme growing vertically. After 3 years in business, Nordic Harvest Farm is now looking to expand its output and production.
So right now we are planning to expand in Germany, Norway and Sweden over the next 3 years.
Anders Ryman is the founder and CEO of Nordic Harvest. Before this venture, he was a business analyst at a shipping company and also worked at a bank.
I was frustrated that traditional agriculture practices did not cater for using less space than we do today. So after a lot of thinking, I found out that maybe vertical farming would be able to produce much more food on an optimized space inside cities without use of pesticides, and to cater for agriculture land to be converted back into their original state, namely forests.
Nordic Harvest was established in 2020. This 75,000 square foot warehouse opened a year later. During that time, the company has experimented with different seeds to improve their yield, tweaking what they grow and the settings for the plants to grow in.
What we discovered in the last 3 years is that it's actually much more difficult to grow plants in this environment than we expected. When you grow in a laboratory, it's a completely different story from when you grow in an actual production facility.
Some plants now have a yield several times greater than when the company first started production. For example, they can harvest certain types of lettuce 30 times a year. Nordic Harvest is now looking into the possibility of recycling the roots from their produce.
In terms of possibilities, developing the business when you have a production facility like ours, then there will be tons of opportunities to dig within the circular economy. So for instance, when we harvest, we have green roots, which we can either experiment and put in our fertilizer, or maybe we can use them as medium to grow mushrooms or other things. So we are investigating this a bit.
An agriculture group says bringing down the prices of rice to 20 pesos per kilo remains far-fetched. CINAG is reacting to President Marcos's claim government is close to achieving his campaign promise of lower rice prices. The price of local rice ranges from 34 to 42 pesos per kilo.
Ang presyo ng palay ngayon is nasa 23.50. Oh, palay pa lang yun. Ibig sabihin, yung palay, igigiling mo pa yan para maging bigas. Oh. Yung 20 to 23 pesos na palay, pag giniling yun, babagsak 40 pesos na bigas. Kung bumalik siguro sa 800 pesos yung ang pataba. Tapos ang fuel natin bubaba ng 32 pesos.
Ay.
Yung seeds natin, kung libre na ibigay sa magsasaka. Tapos ang pain natin, nasa 25 pesos baka realistic by one and a half years.
Philippine senators pushing for constitutional amendments briefed civic groups in Cebu province on details of their proposal. The details from Sherian Torres.
Charter change proponent Senator Robin Padilla consulted various Cebu-based groups Thursday about their thoughts on a hybrid constitutional convention recently approved by the lower house compared to a constituent assembly, which is his preferred vehicle to amend the charter. He was joined by PDP Laban party mate Senator Ronald De La Rosa. Padilla argues only 46 million pesos will be spent via CONAS if it's held simultaneously with the village and youth council elections in October. But if it's done separately, the cost balloons to more than 13 billion pesos. CONCON, according to Padilla, will need a budget of over 14 billion pesos if it's part of local elections, but the cost jumps to 28.5 billion pesos if conducted separately. Padilla points out the amount can be used to bankroll several government initiatives, like supporting the pension of indigent senior citizens, paying for healthcare workers, or funding the construction of more than 11,000 classrooms.
Dapat marinig po ng lahat, lalo na ng mga ng araw-araw na naghahanap buhay at nag-aambag sa kaban ng bayan, na magmumula sa kanilang pinaghirapang buwis ang 14.7 billion hanggang 28.5 na billion na gagastusin sa CONCON.
Padilla notes relaxing the Constitution's conservative economic provisions is crucial to attract foreign investors, an argument disputed by Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri. Zubiri maintains government only needs to fully implement the Public Services Act, the Trade Liberalization Act, and the Foreign Investment Act. The three new economic laws aim to attract more investments. These also led him to question the delay in the release of the implementing rules and regulations of these laws. Congressman Rufus Rodriguez, chairman of the House Committee on Constitutional Amendments, called Zubiri's statements foul, adding that it is pure speculation. Rodriguez further argues the House has no control over the executive agencies tasked to implement the three laws by issuing implementing rules and regulations. House Speaker Martin Romualdez, on the other hand, says their quick work in the lower house is in the interest of improving the economy and not for politics. Former Economic Planning Secretary Ernesto Pernia sides with Zubiri, saying government should wait for the economic laws to be fully implemented. He adds the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, or RCEP, must also be supported because of its huge trade benefits. RCEP aims to establish clear rules in doing trade and investments in the region so that it will be more convenient and competitive for Philippine business and investors.
I would suggest that we first attend to these three bills that have already been passed in Congress, but kulang pa ng push at saka implementation.
On Monday, Padilla will continue his CONCON consultation hearing along with congressmen. Sherian Torres, ABS-CBN News.
a scrap ship turned into an oil tanker. That's how Philippine Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Remulla described the sunken MT Princess Empress that caused the oil spill in Oriental Mindoro. It was also revealed that the oil spill could have been prevented if the ship heeded gale warnings. More from Dennis Datu.
New findings on the sunken MT Princess Empress, which caused an oil spill in Oriental Mindoro. Justice Secretary Boying Remulla says the tanker was not a brand new vessel as initially claimed by the owners, but was actually a rebuilt scrap ship.
Mayroon misrepresentation sa sinumulat sa pool sa kung nangyari itong kasong ito. Nung unang meeting namin na Sabado, ang bitaw pa sa amin na salita na ang sinabi lang nila sa Coast Guard ay bagong-bago itong barkong ito. At hindi pa na siya bago. Ito yung luma na, scrap na siya, na nirebuild. Una nirebuild para maging LPG carrier, tapos nirebuild na naman, pinahaba para maging tanker.
Remulla says they have an affidavit executed by a witness to probe this. Remulla adds there were already gale warnings last February 27.
February 28, madaling araw, sinabihan na sila ang karagatan, medyo mahirap, daanan, pero hindi rin pinansin, tumuloy pa rin sila.
Meanwhile, the Philippine Coast Guard accompanied members of the media to the location of the sunken vessel to let them witness firsthand what's being done to contain the oil spill. The Japan Coast Guard Disaster Relief Team also participated in the said activity. Aside from the oil spill booms deployed by the authorities within the area, workers from Malayan Towage and Salvage Corporation, who were tapped by the vessel owner, continue to spray dispersants. According to them, they can collect 10 to 20 liters of thick oil per hour. They are also applying a technique taught by the Japan Coast Guard to easily break apart thick oil deposits.
Ang in-advise daw po nila ay yung tugboat sa nakita nyo po na magbibigay ng dispersal sa oil. Sa likod po nila itong barko, bubulabugin po yung oil para mabulabog po yung oil habang ginagamit po nila yung water cannon.
Nakakatulong yung pag-spray ng tubig para panipisin niya yung makakapal na part ng oil. And mas madali siyang ma-disperse pagka maliliit yung oil. Kaya yun yung use nitong water cannons natin.
Ang paggamit ng dispersant ay yun yung last resort natin. As much as possible, ang gusto natin gawin ay i-recover yung oil sa dagat.
Sa pamamagitan
po ng pag-skimming and then yung manual na collection doon sa mga na-collect natin gamit ang oil spill boom.
Oil deposits continue floating into the waters and have already expanded up to 5 kilometers. If not collected, this may soon reach the shores. According to Philippine Coast Guard, at least 6,603 liters of oily water mixture and 57 sacks of contaminated materials have been collected from the sea, and over 1,300 sacks and 22 drums of contaminated waste from 13 barangays in Pola and Nauhan. The Japan Coast Guard Disaster Team, meanwhile, lauds the effort exerted by the Philippine Coast Guard to contain the oil spill.
We also acknowledge that these measures taken by the PCG and the Philippine authorities have been contributing to mitigating the damage from this disaster.
On Thursday morning, a substantial amount of oil spill was detected in Herrera Village in Dauhan Town, while traces of oil were found along the shores of Sichu Tuhud. Dennis Datu, ABS-CBN News, Oriental Mindoro.